Hello, everybody, and welcome to RollPlay Live Swan Song. I hope you like that little animated short and your lovely preview of my friends, Jeff and Weed. Big ups to Sir Scoots for putting in all the hard work. So I am your space master, Adam Coble. If you've been watching the Swan Songs, you recognize most of this cast. But let's revisit them again, shall we? Because we haven't played a game in a long time, some of us. To my right, I have, of course, Marcus.
Fuck yeah! I am fucking hype as fuck right now! That show didn't start hype enough, so I'm going to go ahead and get it started. I'm djWHEAt. I play Piani. I'm so excited to be back as Piani. Maybe. I don't know. Sorry, Jeff.
I love how in the pregame warm-up, you're like, I'll never go louder than this.
Oh,
Scott, who we heard at 3 a.m. last night, like, check. And he's like,
fuck you.
You know what? djWHEAt will never get louder than this.
No, djWHEAt is not.
What's up, everyone? Really excited to be here.
I don't say.
I don't want to say anything else. I just want to start playing. Let's go. Jeff, this guy.
Oh, wow. I've got so much to say.
Great. I'll cut you off when it's time. The music will just start playing, Jeff. You'll know it's your cue to move on.
I'm excited to be here as well. This is my first live show. It's only the third one, I guess, right?
Yeah, third one.
So this will be really, really fun. D&D in person is what I've heard. Well, not D&D.
We had this conversation.
I'm a victim as well.
We're streaming under D&D, so you're fine.
Categorically Dungeons & Dragons.
Tabletop
and we have a staff here who's allowing it, so we can't.
Highly modified rule set, okay, guys? Like...
What version of D&D is this? It's a space one.
yeah, we're all elves now, so that's cool.
So I'm excited to be here as well. It's been really fun. We've been it's always a good group of people, and also Matt Mercer. So it's just, you know, like, yeah. Starting off on the right note, all your fans are like, oh, who's that guy? I don't like him, actually. Joking. That's it. I'm happy to be here. I'm excited.
Well, thanks, Jeff. Thank you. And, of course... To my left.
Hi. I'm not gonna blow my mic like Wheat did earlier. That was a good audio test though to start off the show. Thank you for that.
Stress test.
Did it peak?
If you gotta blow something though, make it a mic. You know what I mean?
That's true. That's true. That's what they
and
say.
If you don't know any mics,
I was gonna say, shout out to Mike.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Joke about blowjobs.
It's this for 8 hours. That's all
starting
I gotta say.
On a high note.
Yeah. That's all I have. Matt, introduce yourself.
Hi, Matt Mercer, and I'm happy to be doing this with you guys in person. I played with a few of you via the internets, and I'm excited to be out here at this fantastic table and set, which looks amazing. So well done.
It's a space station.
It is.
That's true.
We're actually playing this on a space station. It was really expensive to get
Patreon
this put together.
Patreon pays really well.
Yeah. Elon Musk.
Good man, SpaceX.
Good man. Yeah, put us in SpaceX. My bones are atrophying as we speak. It's really uncomfortable. I wish I was
joking,
on Earth.
But Adam's maglocked to that spot, actually.
Huge moon boots. Yeah, it's true. So, we're picking up after episode 50 of Swan Song. We've got the characters that you were familiar with from the end of the episode. There's going to be a couple of little changes. If you are not caught up, if this is your first Swan Song experience, that's okay. It's going to be all right, I promise. You're going to have a good time.
This is the Serenity movie form.
I mean, we'll see. I hope that it's not. So we did the little catch-up video yesterday, and we've been, as a group, kind of reminiscing about all the stuff that happened in Swan Song. But I think what we'll do is probably just start it off. We'll just do the hard start, and we'll introduce the characters as they are reintroduced to us. So let's do it.
We should also state that none of us know how Adam's going to start this, except for, I think, Matt.
Yeah.
For some reason, he told Mercer everything, so...
Matt is the only one who knows what's going on. These folks know what character they're playing, but...
Yeah, this is, like, better than Christmas, you guys. Like, I'm, like, so fucking stoked right now.
Yeah.
Tell him Piani's dead. I mean, it's
Merry Christmas.
Yikes.
Sorry.
Get the fuck out.
Yeah. So
if you flip your sheet over, it's Howard, actually. So
yeah, you're playing an octopus now. Yeah. You're also dead. So the show opens on the blackness of space. We can see in the background tiny points of light, but we're clearly far from any habitable system. There's no sun, no planets in view. As the camera slowly pans across, we can hear the deep sort of sub-bass rumble of a large ship. And the ship comes to meet the frame from the other side, and we can see that it's old. The ship is huge and gray, and it looks like it's suffered from many years of use. There are faded logos that have been painted over time and time again on the side, to the point where we can't recognize them except as a sort of smear of color against the gray of the ship's hull. And the subtitles come up at the bottom, and they say RSV Insufficient Gravitas, Sector 105, Deep Space. And the rumble continues as we see the ship, and we can see that it's mostly a cargo ship. There are these massive cargo containers, and at the bottom of the ship there's a tiny little cockpit, and we can see some figures moving around in the light. And as the ship glides slowly across the frame, we can see that it's on its way to intercept a smaller ship. And this ship, I mean, it's kind of a piece of shit. It's obviously been very badly damaged. There's a tear in one side that's been kind of half-assedly repaired. There's someone's face painted.
Paint job.
Yeah, there's someone's face painted on one side of it. We can only see it from one angle, and then it fades as the little ship appears. And the Insufficient Gravitas is huge. It's a much larger ship, and so its shadow falls across the Swan Song as this ship goes to essentially to pick it up. So we fade to black, and the darkness is broken by the sudden harsh sound of a plasma cutter. We can hear the sparking sounds, and the screen lights up bright with the cutter slowly moving its way around, breaking a hole in the external side of the Swan Song. And this plate of metal falls into the ship, and we can see the kind of misty light from outside. We can see illuminated the catwalk, the deck of the ship. We can see the corridor, a hallway there, and there are, reflecting the light, there are fine, crystalline sort of filaments that seem to be growing on the walls and in some of the corners of the corridor. And as the camera adjusts to the light, we see a group of figures dressed in spacesuits step through. There's three of them. One of them, we get a lingering shot on her face through the mask. And it's Lenore. Can you describe your character's face to us? At least what we see in the frame.
What you see within the little window of the front of the spacesuit, you see a woman, early 40s, emaciated, with a very very pale, almost translucent skin due to just a life with a lack of a lot of sunlight. The hair is jet black and slicked back, but some of it has kind of fallen in the front of her face. Her sockets are sunken a bit, and her eyes seem to be intense but ever watchful, and kind of systematically taking in all the details around her as she passes by.
So as she passes by, I think we see the last member of the salvage crew follow you onto the ship, and we see on his chest there's a nameplate that says Fujiwara, and he comes on over the comms. His is the first voice that we hear. And what's your character's last name? It's Lenore Zimmerman?
Zimmerman.
Right. So there's a crackle of the comms, and Fujiwara says, you dragged us all the way out here, Zimmerman. This better be it.
Trust in me, Fujiwara. I have a feeling that this may be important to us.
There's another voice, an older woman's voice that comes on. Space Russian. It's fine. Yes. Another woman's voice comes on over the comms, impatient sounding, a bit older, and you recognize her. Maybe we get a shot of her. Her faceplate is sort of fogged over, but it says Gerardo on her outfit, her spacesuit is the same as the rest of yours, but she's got a faded mission patch on the shoulder that's in the shape of a beaker with a stylized R on the top of the beaker. Mm-hmm. We haven't seen this symbol for a long time, but way back at the sort of outset of the Swan Song's voyage, you took a job from Richardson Scientific, And this is their marker. Now this mission patch doesn't look like
it's current.
We call
it dick science for slang.
Yeah, it's important. It's an important study. Dick science. It's actually named after him. That's the founder.
I'm yeah,
yeah. Richard Science.
You guys laugh, but it's true.
Yeah.
So the three of them, Gerardo and Fujiwara and Zimmerman, you enter this ship, and for you, you feel a sense of familiarity, like that this place, even though you've never been on board this ship, as you walk past the mess hall, you know, you can see floating in space because the ship's off, so it's gravity. There's empty bourbon bottles kind of drifting through the through the atmosphere, and you know you've seen this scene before. You walk past a room cluttered with ancient computer equipment, and there's a wheelchair sort of stuck in one corner. And we follow you towards the core of the ship. You feel yourself being drawn there. And when you get there, there's the computer core. And it's obvious that this particular free trader has been heavily refitted, especially the core. It has much more power than a ship of its size would ever need. Mm-hmm. Even with the upgraded spike drive, there's something else that this system would be designed to power. And in front of you, and we see this in the whole ship is dark, so you just have your like hand flashlight, maybe one built into your suit. We see your vision pass across a console. And on the screen, there's just a single blinking green cursor and a power switch. And I think almost before you realize it, we see your gloved hand enter the frame, like reaching for the switch. Mm-hmm. But you notice that you're doing this, and I don't know, what do you do?
Well, if it comes this far, I kind of lean over and look to my compatriots to make sure that nobody is going to stop me.
Yeah. I think you can hear, like, Fujiwara is somewhere else. You can hear him cluttering around in another room looking for valuables to pillage.
Okay, I'll notify them over the comms just so they don't freak out. I'm like, it appears I've gotten to the core. I'm going to attempt to take the ship online.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, we see you reach out and your gloved hand hits the button, and there's a high-pitched whine that as the core spins up that we hear, and the blinking on the monitor stops, and a hologram appears over the monitor. It's about, you know, a couple of feet tall, wide. It's a triangular shape with little circles on it. It appears to be a slice of pizza. So this pizza hologram just flickers into appearance, and it's just sort of sitting here, transmitted from below, slowly turning in space as the ship runs through its diagnostics.
I slowly nod my head and blink my eyes over the comms. I really hope that there is something here important. Keep looking, please.
All right. So so it's as the system powers up, we can see on the screen the varying systems. So it reads, navigation offline, weapon systems offline, life support offline, and it's bringing up all these things and testing them. And finally, when it gets to the bottom and it says computer core, we get a little green online, and there's a squeal of static in your helmet, and it doesn't seem like Fujiwara and Gerardo don't respond to this, mm-hmm. but maybe they don't hear it. But in your helmet, you hear this like squeal, and then there's a pause where you can hear an open channel, and then you hear a voice that says, "Hello."
Hello.
And the voice is it's quiet. It's obviously computer simulated, but it's a pretty good simulation of a human voice. There's a slight tenor that sets it off, that you recognize that it's not like a person communicating with you. It might be the ship's virtual intelligence.
Right. I see.
And when you respond, it says, "I don't recognize your voice. Who is this?"
This is Adept Lenore Zimmerman. I'm here under the guise and interests of Richardson Scientific. We have come to this derelict ship and have interest as to what its purpose and or where the crew might be.
I've been wondering that myself. Welcome to the Swan Song. They called me Pi.
Pi?
I used to make pizza. The oven's offline. I'm sorry.
The pause. That's quite all right. Perhaps it will be time later for Pi. But for now, we need answers.
Hold on. The ship seems mostly offline. I haven't heard from the crew in some time. I'm worried about them. Have you found anyone else on board? And I think at that point you hear like a startled like shout. You hear Fujiwara be like, holy shit! And there's like a clattering. And he's like, there are people alive on here. And we cut to Fujiwara, and he's knocked over something. And in the room that he's in the cargo hold. And the cargo hold is infested with these crystalline structures. Mm-hmm. So there are these like huge sort of quartz growths kind of filling the inside of the ship. And he staggers back, and when he looks up, we get his point of view reflected in the helmet, and in the crystalline structures, we can see three human figures frozen in this crystal, and I will have them describe themselves to you. So I think that as Fujiwara looks across, the first thing he sees is the former captain of the ship, Wilbur Higgins. What does Higgs look like?
Well. I think I have a fireback question. What were we doing when this happened? Because there's multiple answers to this that I could give you. I just need to know the context.
He wants to know if he can say he's in his underwear. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean,
you said there's floating alcohol, so clearly.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean.
I was definitely drunk when I entered this state, apparently.
I mean, I think, and we'll talk about when you're revived, we'll talk about what you remember.
Okay.
But 50-50. You go ahead and describe whatever you think we would see, and then we'll talk about.
All right, we'll probably see.
5'6", you're naked.
Well, I've got my underwear on, my tidy whities. So you see a middle-aged man, slick black hair, kind of like brownish, slick back, who's probably got a grin on his face for some dumb reason, and he's probably given the finger to the woman who's frozen in the crystals next to him.
Not what you guys are thinking, though.
Yeah, yeah. And he's probably grabbing his crotch with his other hand.
Perfect.
Yes. It is.
So that's how
thinking.
He's frozen. Doesn't look too healthy, but he's probably got some sort of liquid on his face right here. Kind of, you don't know if it's slobber, if it's alcohol, if he's drunk or what. But he's definitely in a fit of rage, yelling at the person next to him.
I'm getting Encino Man flashbacks.
Yeah. That's probably pretty
okay,
accurate.
Okay, cool. Yeah, all right, good. All right, Brendan Fraser, sure. So, yeah, we pan down your arm to the bird at the end and then across, and then we see Piani. What do you look like?
Piani's instantly, obviously, you see the eye. Her left eye is not a real eye. It's a cybernetic eye with short hair. Blonde. She also looks very angry in what is going on. In fact, it's like full on mouth open, like something was being said mid freeze, potentially. Wearing just a simple white tank top and some cargo pants and boots, like kind of what you'd expect a crew to wear, like a maybe even still like a little jacket tied around her waist. And yeah, that's Piani.
Cool. All right. So we continue along, and the last figure encased, I mean, questionably human, the last figure encased in the,
I was gonna
the crystalline.
Say,
yeah.
He would have taken offense, actually.
Yeah.
He said three people in there. He's like,
two people and an android cyborg,
yeah.
I guess.
So Alpharius, as always, is a man of simple pleasures, I would say. He's wearing his body glove or whatever, just kind of a singular skin tight outfit. I think what's interesting about him is that because of the stasis that they're in, none of his, what would you call it, like illuminating effects are on. Because
none of your tributes. None of your ground effects.
No, he doesn't have he's no mohawk, no beard. His eyes are not glowing. They're all dim. But you can see a frozen, perplexed look as he's looking at the other two. Still trying to figure out what's going on.
Cool. So we see these things and... Yeah, and how are you reacting? Do you leave to go and meet with Fujiwara?
As soon as I hear Fujiwara shout, I instinctually turn and give a couple of steps haste in that direction, mm-hmm. kind of slow and turn. My hands kind of still outstretched towards the AI, kind of linger for a minute, and then slowly begin to pick up pace towards Fujiwara.
Sure. So as you head to the cargo hold, the comms panels on the wall next to you light up in turn and then fade as you're passing, as the AI follows you through the ship. And okay. I think you, when you come into the room, the camera in the cargo hold turns on and pans over. And so Pi is seeing the things that you are. And I think that Dr. Gerardo is in the room already. Mm-hmm.
They aren't currently attempting to touch or cut into the substance.
The two of them are just standing there. Dr. Gerardo is having a conversation. You're not like on the comms with her, but you know who she's talking to. The pilot of the ship, Gant. He doesn't go on away team missions. Mm-hmm. She's talking to him.
Okay.
When you come in, she's ostensibly in charge of this
okay.
operation.
While she's distracted with, again, I turn to Fujiwara and it's like, have you done a diagnostic to see what the substance is?
And he looks up at you and he's like, a diagnostic? And he like gestures. He's like, there's a man in his underwear frozen in crystal. And he's like, all right. Fine. He like reaches into his pack and he pulls out a big like scientific analysis device on a cord. And he starts running the scan. You can make a science test if
actually,
you want to.
I have metatool. That's Phineas.
Yeah. So what?
Scott, he's rolling dice.
What is your approach? Like, if you're trying to figure out if they're still alive or like get a scan on them, it would be medical.
I'm scanning to see what this crystalline substance is.
Okay.
In hopes of seeing if there's a safe way to remove them without destroying them.
Sure.
Mm. Or if we have any sort of, you know, or danger to us if we attempt to touch or interfere with it. So.
Okay. I think in this case the applicable skill is going to be tech-sci-tech.
Tech-sci-tech. Okay.
Yeah, roll with intelligence.
Here's where you tell us it's like a -3.
Well, it's a straight roll now because I have not skilled in it, but I have +1 intelligence. So.
So hey to you.
Nice.
Not bad.
Okay. All right.
Not bad.
So you can't be 100% certain because mm-hmm. this isn't your area of expertise, but this crystal is a particular kind of like psychically resonant crystal. It mm-hmm. would be very dangerous if there was a psychic on your crew, but there definitely isn't. It's reactive to people with MES. It's very fragile. You can take it apart fairly easily.
Okay.
And you should be able to extract them if they're still alive.
Right. Okay.
You've definitely never seen it in this quantity.
What do I
say? You've also never seen a person encased in it before.
Right.
So.
Okay. I immediately turned to Fujiwara. I was like, I think we're safe to remove the subjects. Let's go ahead and remove them from the crystalline cocoon and inspect to see if there's any signs of life. And begin reaching out and just like pulling apart pieces.
Yeah. So Fujiwara looks at you and sees you, you know, breaking with your hands, and he shakes his head. And he's like, "I'll get the saw," and he like walks off. We hear his boots like, and I think that's sort of the end of the scene. We hear his boots clunking on the deck, and we pass across to you, and you're starting to break away some of the extant crystal, and Dr. Gerardo is just kind of like staring at the three of them, like nodding, and then in the background we see the camera like refocus, and we fade to black. And we fade in on what looks like a medical facility. So very sterile, like brushed steel, white linen beds, and the three of you are in these little like they're like sci-fi beds. So they're kind of like cradles. And there's all this like life support monitoring equipment and everything. Let's have everybody roll the three of you anyway. Roll a physical effect save. I want to see who wakes up first.
Okay. All right. Let's study the sheet.
20,
figure out what the fuck.
D20. I got a 13.
Yeah, 10. Just
yeah, I got a 13.
All right.
12. Not you.
Yep.
Yeah, I wake up. Well.
Yeah, 18.
16.
Okay.
16. 16. Okay.
I needed a 10.
I need a 14 okay. or higher.
So you're 6 above what you needed.
And
a 1. So it's a good sleep.
So you wake up in hour 7.
So here's what happens. So yeah, we see the camera pan slowly across Alfarius in the bed, and then Piani kind of sleeping fitfully, and Higgs, and we just hear beep beep beep, and then we just pan up to the ECG, and say Higgs dies. Thanks for coming. He didn't make it. Maybe next time. No. So you're all still asleep, but Alfarius. Yeah. Maybe because of your natural fortitude. Maybe because of your cybernetics. Your system reboots itself, and you jar awake in this hospital.
Yeah. He's like laying there. Like you said, it's super clean white linens. He's just like laying there, but his eyes kind of like one after the other blink on, and the beard powers up, and the mohawk, and he's like. He's just, well, I mean, when handling bull herds in such quantities, and he kind of like starts saying that and looks around, he's like, and then he mumbles to himself, he says, security breach. He starts to kind of remove himself from the bed.
Mm-hmm.
And as he gets, he like slinks up and he like just shirks, and his blade comes out of his arm again.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes over to Piani and starts just like shaking her while looking around really carefully.
Yeah, yeah. So you're walking over to Piani and you start to shake her. And
super inappropriately, like on her chest, probably. Just whatever. Just like
you're just not looking. So just grab a handful of Piani. Okay. Sure. So yeah, Piani, you wake up.
So I want to ask
a question
before steel
hand in your boob.
I want to ask because there's like I feel like two potential ways to react.
Yeah.
Maybe more. Like what would I consciously have as like the last thing I remember?
I mean, things have been complicated for you of late. You seem to remember two separate things occurring simultaneously, right? You remember...
Right.
And maybe this is one of those kind of Mass Effect style, like, intense flashback situations where you remember both a conversation with Viktor Kovacs, who you know to be long dead. You remember a tree in a storm.
Okay.
But you also remember... being on the Swan Song, you remember Anaximander University. You remember a fountain,
mm-hmm.
But above and through all of that, you remember this feeling of fear of the future. Right, you remember your visions.
Awesome.
Of
you wake up though to the top half. No,
here's
his face.
Actually,
his arms over you.
Here's how it is. Is that I'm like kind of sleeping on my side, and I'm sleeping as if I would be looking towards Higgs.
Sure.
So, I feel basically, you know, it's like maybe the eyes like slid open immediately, and I feel the hand go on there, and I don't even hear that. But like my first reaction is like fucking Higgs. But when my eyes like open up, I think I see Higgs over there, right. And I'm like, who the fuck is Arferius?
You must be quiet. There has been a security breach. Simply have to insist that you do not talk at your normal temper.
I'm like finally just sort of.
And Alpharius is wearing like a hospital gown.
They took my body glove.
Yeah. Yeah, oh, yeah. Shit.
Then I'm in a hospital gown,
and it has a little like a Richardson Scientific like logo on the front.
Well,
of
let me ask you this then, because as we're talking, I open my chest up and reach in.
Yeah, you like reach for your gun.
Yeah. Is it in there?
Yep.
Yeah. Sweet. So I'm like, so yeah, I open my chest up and pull out my mag pistol and go, Piani, you must revive Higgins. I will secure the door.
I think I look over.
Off.
I'm like, oh. Higgins is dead. We should just go.
You've got like a pillow over his face. Like he's fine. He's fine.
No,
don't worry about
no,
him.
I'm like, but say, what?
That explains the one.
What the fuck are we?
I'm like checking the door. I'm like, Piani, simply put, we must address the situation at hand before we answer such lofty questions.
So maybe I, you know, whatever, pull fucking IV out and stop the squirting blood for a second and like kind of hobble over to Higgs. And I just kind of give him a nice little knuckle to the kidney. Like, Higgs!
Does that wake me up?
I want you to make
a... I think you do yell, though, and he likes...
Make another physical effect save.
Okay.
What if you roll one again?
14 or higher. 19.
All right,
oh,
cool.
I thought that was a 2. Right,
so
you
wake up and... It's a shock, but it's not damaging to you. But yes, just
gives you a
punch. That wakes him the fuck up. Actually,
yeah,
it wasn't really a punch. It was literally like, you know, it kind of extended. Nick, and you just kind of give him a little nick like that.
Okay,
it's like a severe thump.
Same question as Piani. What do I remember as my thoughts as I immediately wake up? I have a reaction already, but I think for you
and Alpharius, things are much less clear. I think you have a very foggy sense of what's going on.
Okay.
Yeah, you're having a harder time. Like, you can remember, obviously, like, your name and the basic stuff about who you are, but the last thing you can remember is much harder to get at. It's slippery.
Okay. I wake up after being knuckle-punched in the kidney by Piani and just say, fuck you! And I just punch him straight in the face, not knowing who it is.
You're right, yeah, like you do. Okay.
Hold on. I am standing
again
on the bed. Higgs is like, oh, like...
No, I'm just saying that's what I try to do. I don't necessarily connect.
It's like,
okay.
Rolls over.
Okay.
Roll.
I just like...
Make the roll.
I mean, you gotta make an unarmed attack roll.
D20,
why not?
Unarmed attack.
Like, I feel like that would be it.
Here's the thing. So, do you have a bonus to your dexterity?
No.
Negative.
Okay. All right. So your armor class is 10 because you're not wearing any armor. And so you're going to roll a d20.
It's
you're
d20.
Gonna, you're going to add 10. D20. Yeah, roll a d20. You're going to add 10 for their armor
Wait
class.
A second.
But like, I was about to say, do you have any psychic powers?
I mean,
like
Omen would definitely make me go like, oh, Higgs is going to fucking punch me.
Right. Yeah. So this is a great intro to the fact that you're a crazy drunk and that you have psychic powers in that. Yeah. Don't bother rolling. What we see, I think, is Piani, you come up and you give him the punch and then he rolls over and punches you in the face and you fall on the ground. And then you blink, and you're standing there like you haven't done the punch yet. And you're like, yeah, maybe I'm going to do. So do you want it? You can still punch him, but they don't flail, or you poke him, but they'll flail at you. What do you want to do? Do you want to try a gentler approach?
Yeah, of course.
Shake him awake. And so,
well,
same thing.
I mean, I'm
same
like,
thing.
I'm not going to let Higgs get the best of me like that, so of course I'm going to. Yeah,
yeah, Higgs takes the swing, but you're just not where you were.
Do you
the
still
last
yell
time.
And stuff?
Oh, yeah. No, same exact reaction. Okay.
Yeah.
I think you hear the slight, like this, the padding of, you know, feet on tile as I come over, and I put my hand over your mouth quite forcefully. And I'm like, Captain, it's important that you understand the sit rep.
Get your hand off my fucking face!
Right now, Utama is why we...
I'm like...
It's totally... It's why
I can't fucking...
What? I think he, like, slides one finger aside to, like, let some out.
It's like letting the air out of a balloon.
Yeah, I'm looking around. How far is... Where the fuck are we?
Precisely my predicament.
So while these three are waking up, we see behind them a black glass wall, which, as we get the camera shift, is obviously a two-way mirror. And now out of your
what?
Yeah, out of your all the you're out of your spacesuit. How is your character dressed when you're just on the gravitas?
On the gravitas, very simple long sleeve, long coat with a white linen shirt that hangs almost to the knees, and then kind of beige pants and slippers. Like very simple, almost like a Zen business person.
Right. Cool. Yeah. Okay. So we see Lenore. We also see Chandra, Dr. Dorado. She's in her 60s. She's an Indian woman. She's wearing a lab coat and similarly modest outfit. Otherwise, she has a pair of silver framed glasses, and she's standing next to you. And then we see the pilot, Lawrence Gant, standing next to her. And Gant is a tall, thin, black guy. He's probably from Andoni. Very serious look. He constantly has this look on his face like he needs to be somewhere else and has more important things to do. But he's here watching, and the three of you see this stuff happening. And Dr. Dorado looks over at you and says, well, I think we should introduce ourselves.
I think in the background you see me flipping my bed over to barricade the door.
Yeah.
I literally,
that's good. Yeah, barricade the door, smart plan.
And as I watch this happening, I kind of lean over to Dr. Gerard and be like, perhaps we should announce before we enter.
Yeah.
I would recommend.
So Gant leans over and he like clicks the button, and all of you in the room, you hear like click as the audio comes on.
Yeah.
And you hear a slightly bored voice come over and say, so we were hoping we could come in and have a conversation with you, but the whole gun thing is making us a little squirrely.
And in slow motion from my side, I pull out the finger guns and point it at the wall. And I just say, who am I speaking to right now?
And he clicks off and he looks over at Chandra and at you, and Chandra's like, go ahead. And clicks back on. He says, my name is Lawrence Gant. I'm a pilot of the ship. We found you floating out in space. You're not our prisoners or anything, but we wanted to clear up a few things.
We'll start clearing it up. You got us in a room. It's been barricaded, so...
Captain, ask him why we're naked.
What is a swan song?
So the thing clicks back on and...
My crew has a couple questions. Please address them.
Yeah, and Gant's like, maybe we could have this conversation face-to-face. You want to just set the gun down? You're not in any danger
when
here.
When he says that, I'm like, all right.
But yeah, so Alfarious, I mean, you've got this situation barricaded. You're behind the steel bed. You've knocked over. You got your gun. But they, I mean, you can make a roll to see if they're being serious about being peaceful, because you're obviously like on the ready.
I think there's not really a roll. He's just going to look at Higgins and let him decide. So
they're wanting
to, just looks at you.
They're wanting to come in the room?
Yeah, they only want to come in and not get shot to death.
Yeah, well, Alfarious, go and remove. I mean, maybe we got lucky. Maybe this is one of those pleasure ships, you know? Maybe this is all a... Maybe I'm dreaming. Open the fucking door right now.
No,
open it up.
Only just let two of them in. Just because
he's
we can
a cyborg.
Take
he can't
three.
Fuck any. Yeah, two people, please. Only two. Let him in.
Probably take on two. Most any two.
And that
certainly.
That response, I see Gant about to motion, but instead I just kind of give the option to sit down, look out at Gerard, and be like, perhaps we would be a better use in this conversation.
Yeah, and Gant nods, and Jesse's just like, ladies first.
Yeah.
And he hits the door open, and so you all hear the hiss as the door slides open. And then Lenore and Dr. Gerardo come into the lab.
He looks at them, and without breaking eye contact, opens his chest and puts his gun away.
Yeah,
but
I'm
then keeps the
there.
Blade out because he thinks he's being clever.
Is there something I can raise my leg up on?
Yeah.
Yeah, I raise my leg up and put my arm there.
Sure, and you're wearing a hospital gown, so it's very...
Yeah, and I'm just... Well, hello there. Welcome to my quarters. It's nice to have you.
Most epic Rikering I think I've done in a while.
So, Dr. Gerardo, like, grins a little bit at that and looks at you like... Interesting.
Unexpected, but... Anyway,
she says, you must be confused. Are you feeling all right? And she comes over to you, and she has the sort of bedside manner of like a medical doctor. And so she like comes close to you and she's like, may I? Like she wants to like check your pulse and like.
Yeah, okay. I just kind of like put my hands up like that. You can do whatever you want to me. I just have my arms at my side.
So she, yeah,
can
she
I wink at
I think
after
as you
that.
Say that, Alfarious making a reading of you says, Captain, she's not even a little bit sexually attracted to you.
Alfarious, for the just shut up and let it happen. All right.
He looks at Piani. He's like, you on the other hand also not sexually attracted to as well.
It's good. It's important.
I will now be quiet.
Just let it go.
So she checks to make sure that you're all right, and takes a look at the monitor next to you, and she says, I didn't expect to find anyone out here. We're a scavenging team. I'm sorry. My name is Dr. Chandra Dorado, and she reaches out to like, I guess you're close. It's like shake your hand.
Yeah, a scavenging ship. Where the fuck's my ship?
She nods and she says, it's in our hold. It's still your ship. Don't worry. This is my colleague, Lenore Zimmerman. And she gestures over to this woman that's with her. And she says, Miss Zimmerman has a talent for finding lost things and guided us to your ship. We've been having conversations with your fourth crew member.
I turn to Piani and my eyes widen. I go, oh, fuck. What do you mean, conversations?
She's not attracted to you. There is zero attraction going on.
She says they're very curious. They've been asking a lot of questions. It seems like your ship has been out of commission for, and she gets an awkward look on her face, like she doesn't know how to say the next part, and she just says like, some time. Perhaps it's best that you spoke with your crewmate.
Perhaps it is. When can we do that?
She says, whenever you like.
Well, bring me a wheelchair and let's go.
So she looks at your readout and like...
God fucking damn it. It's been 5 minutes and you're already asking for a fucking wheelchair, Piani.
And she's like, no, It's fine. If you're not feeling well,
she's fine. Look at her.
I'm in a hospital gown for Christ's sake.
So am I. Look at me, and I just pull it all the way.
What kind of hospital are you running here?
She says our facilities are limited, but if you're not feeling well, Ms. Zimmerman, if you don't mind, and she gestures, there's like a wheelchair nearby, and
of course.
Well, you're stuck with that for the next 8 hours. I hope you're under okay, Ms. Zimmerman, whatever. Have fun with that. I'm not pushing that shit around. I just walk over to the corner.
Yeah. So she's like, I'm going to stay here and take a look at some of the data. If you wouldn't mind escorting our guests to their ship.
Not to worry. I will take care of it.
please follow me. I will take you to your swan song.
I think maybe even before we go, I go, can you share the data with us too?
She nods. She says, well, of course. There isn't really anywhere to send it. Your ship is very badly damaged. You may be able to repair it, but for now, only the computer core seems to be online.
Well, just send it to the computer core then.
She nods, and she brings up a keyboard and starts to do some work as you are led out into the
All right.
Yeah, into the ship. So the inside of the Gravitas is it's worn. It looks like a ship that's been around the block a few times, but it's well maintained. And you've seen, I think, Higgs, especially, you've seen this kind of ship before. They're really large ships, cargo space-wise, but they're meant to run on a minimal crew. Like, you could probably get by with two or three people on this ship total, which, as you know, is the case. There's only four people that are on this ship at any given time. It's kind of a lonely voyage. But it gives you lots of cargo space in case you find something big that you want to scavenge. Unless it's been refitted, probably doesn't have any weapons or anything like that.
Okay.
It's just like a giant warehouse with an engine strapped to it.
I think as we're being led there, it hits me, and I go, hey, Gant, was it? Is that?
Yeah.
I go, have you seen this face? And I make like the gesture, or the face that's on the side of the ship. Have you seen me before? Do you recognize this?
He looks at you, and he's like, your face is on the side of the...
I fucking told you, Piani, it wasn't worthless. It works every
like
time.
Like, face-palming, just like...
They knew exactly...
Can you push us faster?
They knew
do I have
exactly
to walk alongside
what they're
him?
Looking for.
The squeaking.
Which,
get louder.
They get louder and faster. I've already found a kinship in opposition to this brash gentleman.
As we're walking, Alpharius just kind of like looking around says to... Just, Captain, without our equipment, we are as good as sitting.
Oh, right. No, I understand. Yeah. What animal were you going with there again?
The saying's quite clear.
I look towards Gant. You'll get used to it. It's just a thing that happens. It gets real fun when he starts speaking other languages. We just keep going down the hall towards our ship.
All right, so we cut to this cargo hold, and it's for the most part pretty empty. There may be some containers off to the side, but under a big spotlight in the center is the Swan Song.
Okay. I think I stare at it. I'm God damn, that's a beautiful ship. And then just like a piece falls off.
Totally, like a pipe just falls off the side, clatters to the deck.
Zooms out. We can fix that. That can be fixed. I promise.
Yeah. And so you see the Swan Song in all of its damaged glory, and you start heading towards it. And I think that that Lenore, as you're pushing Piani, you get kind of a strange feeling. You find like you said, you find yourself sort of drawn to Piani, but something about it you can't place why. Like, it's not just that she doesn't like this obnoxious guy and it's kind of funny. Like, there's something about her that you're like, yeah, like you feel like pulled to, like a magnetic sort of pull.
Okay.
That you can't quite figure out. And yeah, you get over to the ship, and Fujiwara is there, and he's sitting outside, and one of the ship's external hologram projectors is projecting some kind of like game board onto a crate that Fujiwara has knocked over. So there's this blue hologram like game board, and he's sitting there, he's like smoking a cigarette, and he's moving. He goes to move a piece, and he puts it down, and he shakes his head and like scratches his chin. He's like, "Fuck!" And then the group of you walk over, and he looks at you, and he's like, "Well, I can tell you this, things fucking better than me at chess."
To be fair, everything is. But.
And he scowls at you. He's like. Just goes back to staring at the board angrily. And so you see this guy. You see this Japanese guy. He's got several days of stubble. He's wearing a flight jumpsuit. It has some like industrial combines like identification mark on it. But again, it's old. It looks like the suit and the ship don't match. Like, a lot of that stuff here seems to be kind of cobbled together.
But did you say the crate was outside of the ship?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So they're sitting underneath the ship, and one of the cameras is projecting the hologram of the game board onto the crate. He's sitting outside.
Immediately, like, to me, that's it's like interpreted as like, okay, Pi's there and he's okay. So I'm just going to actually start wheeling myself as fast as I can to the Swan Song. Yeah, like it's just sort of
jog behind to keep up best I can.
Yeah, I don't even know if like the ramp is open or whatever, but I'm just,
I think it is. Yeah, they've been through all the openings to the ship are okay.
If Piani runs along in the wheelchair and you're following and me and Alfaris are left, I lean over and say, you think you can take this ship?
Without a doubt.
I look over and go, wait for the signal.
So as I think as you go by, as like Piani kind of gets out of your hand, and these two kind of go off towards the ship, Fujiwara stands up and like grabs your sleeve before you leave. Mm-hmm. And he's like it's not what we expected, but I did some looking and those crystals, they're very illegal and very expensive. And you can see him, like, he's thinking about the yacht he's going to buy with all the money you're going to make selling these crystals.
Well, make sure that you gather what you can. But for the time being, we owe at least a bit of an explanation to our guests.
And he scowls and he's like, guests? We don't owe them anything. They're space trash. I say, you and I just leave the cargo hold and we flush them.
Let's take some time and see all corners of the situation. My intuition tells me is that there is more beyond just a find of space gold, if you will.
He scowls and he's like, well, when it comes to a vote, I know Gant's going to agree with me. And he gets up and like kind of brushes himself off. And he looks up at the camera that's like displaying the thing. He's like, and fuck you too, computer. And he like walks off, like puts a cigarette on the ground and walks off.
Right. I sigh very audibly, correct my posture, and then continue behind the now very accelerated wheelchair. The
wheeling yourself up the cargo ramp. So you come into the familiar cargo hold of the Swan Song, which I think
it's still bigger, right? Didn't we?
I think yeah. So it's I think it still has a broken car in it. I think you never there's like a totally ruined hover car just like jammed in the back corner.
Yeah.
With like a tarp over it, you'll fix it. It's up on blocks. You'll fix it one day. So it's like jammed in the back corner.
Right?
There's no grav tank.
Right, Adam, because you took it from.
There's
us.
A big empty spot on the floor.
There's a little toy grav tank sitting there.
Grav tank there.
One day
we'll get the real thing, guys.
Yeah. And you walk in and you see there are these like crystal and y'all recognize them right away. Because of all of the bad times they've brought you, but you recognize these crystalline structures kind of built up around the inside of the Swan Song's cargo hold.
I think immediately I would have to have some concern.
Mm-hmm.
So, are they literally all over the ship?
They seem to have grown out of the walls of the ship. Yeah. There's tool marks on a lot of them. Like you can see, there's a sort of stump of crystal with a big buzzsaw like cut across the top. You can see a sled, a little hover sled, where someone has started piling up the pieces. They seem to be like taking them off the ship.
Is there any danger to? I mean, like any sort of psychic power could set this off,
yes.
Right?
Yeah, yeah. If you start throwing around psychic powers, there's a chance you could cause.
And we all know that.
Well,
yes, you all know that. But they do feed back the kind of psychic energy that's put into them. So, for you particularly, you're not that much of a danger because your psychic powers tend to be inwardly focused rather than outwardly focused.
It was more like with Eric, where he was
telekinesis and teleportation.
Okay.
For you, the risk of these crystals is that you might get caught. Like if you start doing a bunch of precognition, you might get caught up in a temporal like mental loop, and it's dangerous for you internally. And like if you were to use your biokinesis on somebody who is nearby with it, they might cause like rapid cell growth in an unexpected way or mutation.
Got it.
Think you're on the ship before us, but I definitely. Do whatever you want to, but the second that I come on the ship, I'm gonna act. So, I'm just letting you know.
Okay.
I could re-equip myself. Is it fair to say I have another body glove and FEP in there and everything?
Well, you wouldn't have another one. Like they have yours, but you'll be able to get it back. You just can't have it right now.
I'm going to just kind of be
They've also sawed off
in
both
that.
Your arms and legs.
Yeah. Well, I forgot to mention that part, yeah.
She's carrying around your head and her arm.
Torso.
Yeah. 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 You familiar with Krang?
Can
from
you take
You've been Kranged. I'm sorry. I think, Piani, you're the first one into the cargo hold, and there is that moment where we get the long pan around of all these like strange crystals in this familiar space.
I will immediately go to my room.
Okay. Sure. So you wheel yourself to your quarters. And I think that when you get to the door, it slides open automatically and the lights in your room come on. And it looks just the way it was the last time you saw it.
Pie?
So there's a crackle. And you hear, hello, Piani. It's good to see you.
Pie? What the fuck is going on?
That's a very good question. I'm afraid I don't have the entire answer yet. I've been piecing things together, but it's complicated.
What? Did they find us on the ship?
They did.
I think, where is your body?
I don't know.
It's not on the ship.
Destroyed, I imagine.
Did they do anything to you?
No. We had some conversations.
Do you think that are bad people?
That, too, is a complicated question. I've been thinking about that a lot. I've had a great deal of time to think.
Pi, exactly how long have you had to think?
If you weren't already sitting down, I'd probably ask you to sit. So there's like a moment, and Pi says, I wasn't sure at first, but it seems like it's been just over 117 years since the last time we spoke.
I think there's like not even a response for a second. Like there's a really long, drawn out silence, and I don't know how like Pi would interpret that, but it's like trying to figure out everything that I think I know, what I know, and right. then how 117 years applies either to, you know, maybe that makes things easier, maybe it makes things harder. So
yeah, and I think we see you struggling with that, and yeah, Pi is just watching. You see the main camera in your room, just kind of focus on your face, a little focusing ring shift. And I think while you're trying to process that, you hear everybody else come onto the ship. Yeah. So you said you had something you wanted
yeah,
to do.
Yeah, so when I walk on, I see all these crystals, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and you're walking on around the same time, or are you already up there?
I'm already up there.
Okay, and Gant and all them are already up there as well?
No, Gant stayed behind. Gant and Fujiwara are having a conversation.
Okay, so only she is up there?
Yeah, Lenore came with you.
Okay. I walk onto the ship, and if you're in earshot, I immediately go, nobody think a fucking thing. Do you know what these... Pi, you there?
There's a click, and Pi says, yes, Captain.
Hey, Pi, have you already taken over the ship? You already got in there? Not this ship. I mean the ship that we're on.
I'm afraid I don't understand what you mean.
Goddamn, Pi, take over the fucking ship already, all right? This isn't fuck around hour. This is serious. Well, why the fuck are all these crystals on the ship?
Even if I weren't badly damaged, it's very rude to just take control of someone's ship like that.
Well, I don't give a fuck about rudeness or not. I don't know what's going on. Why? Answer the question. The crystals.
I step out of the shadows from the long hallway after your doorway to your quarters closed. I
have to agree with your ship. I do find it rather rude to insinuate such a thing.
Well, again,
Captain,
I
also agree. It is impolite.
What? I've got... two things. You sound weird as fuck. I don't like that. Second thing, I'm the captain. Respect that. And Pi, what the fuck are these crystals doing on my ship? That's three. I can't count sometimes.
As for the crystals, I'm not sure. Captain, have you met Lenore? Hello, Lenore.
Hello, Pi.
Yes. Yeah, the funny sounding one. Lenore, nice to meet you. I'm Wilbur Higgins III. It's a pleasure. I thought this was a fucking pleasure ship. It's not. What the fuck's going on, Pi? I'm just like standing in the cargo hall screaming.
Maybe you should talk to Piani about that.
I'm sure you've already... I start just screaming, Piani! Piani!
So you hear the familiar echo of the captain's voice shouting to you from the cargo hold.
Yeah, and I roll out, and I'm, like, not looking forward to this conversation. Uh-huh. Yeah. So it's just, like, very slowly, just kind of bringing it out. What?
Pa said that you talked. What the fuck's going on? These crystals. Don't fucking think.
Well, the crystals I know nothing about. But I learned something about how long we were in the crystals.
How long?
We were taking naps in them. Long naps. The kind you like, but just times a few million.
We were asleep a million years.
She speaks incredibly cryptically.
We were on the ship for 117 years.
I kind of look. I mean, that's not too. A million's kind of hyped it up to a million.
No, your naps are like short 30 minutes and then times a million, which is like equates to. Anyway, 117 years, Higgins. Which means we're really fucking default on our payments for one thing, but I don't know what else it means.
Oh, shit. And I just start running towards my room. Sunbeam's got to be... Wait, and then I run back over to Lenore. Does Sunbeam Interstellar still exist?
So, yeah, the Sunbeam Interstellar, Sunbeam Interstellar is the name of... It's the old name of a company that used to make spaceships. They would make and sell spaceships. There was a brief period of time where they were kind of at war with this pirate fleet, but they made nice, and there was a corporate buyout. They still exist, but maybe not in the form that Higgs is thinking. It's an old-timey name for the current organization.
Based on what we've discussed with Pi and your question, I would say that they do still exist, but perhaps not in the prestige you may recall.
I look towards Piani, then I look over at Alf. And guys, I think the ship's paid for. I mean, it's been totally 117 hard. Fucking years. You think they would have come after us? I think the ship's ours. I mean, mine. I think the ship's mine.
Technically, I would like to remind you that the ship is under the name of one Victor Kovacs.
Well, no, that I say that, and then it zooms in on the ship.
Exactly. And then, that's perfect. That's perfect. Before we go to our first break, you're like, the ship's mine, and then we cut to a stairwell somewhere with a pile of moldering bones.
Very
like
old.
Hundreds of years old moldering bones at the bottom. That's perfect. Thank you for that. So we'll break there. We'll take a short one, and we'll come back. We got lots more Roleplay Live Swan Song for you when we return. Don't go anywhere.